Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents World Music, A Very Short Introduction by Philip V. Bohlman, narrated by Tim Campbell. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface: World Music is very old and very new. It chronicles the ancient and the modern. It lives in the past and in the present. World music sounds the local and the global. It contains stories of the everyday and histories of epochs. It touches the most intimate parts of our lives and expresses the most transcendent qualities of human existence. World music is mobile and material. It circulates as mediated sound and affixes itself to the physicality of objects that sound. It at once encourages the desire and the denial of ownership. In all these ways, world music comes into existence because of its power to connect and to sound the common diversity of all human beings. It is because of the vastness of world music that it has so many and such different meanings wherever we encounter it in the world. In this book, I search for ways to account for the complex conditions whereby music has mapped and remapped the cultures of the world in the past and in the present. There are many possible ways of defining world music or laying claim to musical repertories as global, and it is these, considered as a whole, contradictions and all, that become the subject of this book. There are certain historical moments when definitions account for the presence of music in the world in specific ways. There is no clearer example of such a moment than Herder's coining of the term Volkslied, or folk song, to account for a repertory he had gathered and published from global sources that together signaled a common humanity. Other definitions are more local and parochial. For example, when British record company executives met in a London pub in the summer of 1987 to determine ways that the term world music could provide a way of packaging and marketing the diverse genres of popular music that were increasingly appearing in their catalogs. World music also gained definitional currency when applied to university programs in ethnomusicology, designating centers for world music and generating research programs dedicated to world music as a subject matter. Definitions, then, also connected past to present in pursuit of commonality, even as the ways in which they sought connections across time and space. The connections in which the definitions, and more critically, what I call the acts and conditions of world music, reside, are critical to the structure of the present book. Each chapter contains a set of connections that realize the acts and conditions of world music at specific moments of globalization. In Chapter 1, we concern ourselves with the origins of world music, the acts and conditions that together sound various kinds of beginning, of myth and history, of religion, of discourse about the ontologies and epistemologies of music. Chapter 2 moves decisively toward history, focusing on the ways connections between the West and the rest of the world, especially the conditions of encounter, often result in the unequal distribution of power. Myth and history provide a framework for a wide array of connections in Chapter 3, between fundamental distinctions such as time and timelessness, oral and written tradition, concepts of listening in the Islamic world, and of sounding music in Europe. Chapter 4 examines the most persistent model for world music, folk music, examining closely the conditions of its first appearance as a discourse of global musics, then following the history of that discourse. Similarly, the subject of Chapter 5, Music and the Nation, focuses on a specific set of conditions that have generated genres of world music that portray the nation and its insistence on a selfness, distinguishing it from global partners. In Chapter 6, connections are at their most attenuated in the comparative study of diaspora and music, with examples drawn from the historical longue durée of diaspora, as well as the dramatic proliferation of diaspora as a condition of modernity. World music is no less a presence when the connections are strained to the point of breaking in Chapter 7, which takes empire and globalization as points of departure, but moves critically through the potential of decoloniality to render connections anew. In the concluding chapter, we search for new conditions of world music in the 21st century, especially the materiality affording new meanings that ensure world music matters in a changing world. It is because world music matters that this book gathers perspectives that address the persistent presence of change as a condition of globalization, connecting the past to the present. Change, historical, cultural, political, musical, is a crucial component of ethnomusicological theory and method, especially the ways in which change is intersectional, transforming the musical objects, for example, sounds and sights, to subjects and subjectivity, for example, identity and epistemology. World music affords meaning to individuals and cultures in many ways, distinctive as they are different. Folk music may provide the conduit to world music for some cultures and communities, religious belief for others. World music is often intimate and personal, but it is no less often highly mediated and connected to virtual worlds. Its value may lie in the ways it is shared by a collective, or it may depend on the extent to which economic capital builds cultures of consumption with algorithms. World music is fundamentally material, while at the same time affording agency and mobility. It is the intersectional capacity of world music that lends it the particularly significant potential for analyzing global change today. The sections of this book that examine the most recent connections to a changing world engage the ways in which global history has itself undergone dramatic transformation, bringing about a cultural sea change. New areas of encounter between the West and former colonial regions, especially in the Middle East, North Africa, and their peripheral areas such as Afghanistan and Somalia, have in recent years quickly passed from initial invasion to prolonged civil war and occupation. During the past decade, movements on the right and the left arose in response to such encounters, soon thereafter unleashing new forms of global crisis, especially the forced migration of ethnic and religious minorities. Economic inequality and climate change further exacerbated the conditions undermining the global cultural unity in which world music participated and fraying the connections on which it depended. The present edition of World Music, A Very Short Introduction, is both a history of the present and a search for the presence of history in world music. The perspectives and approaches I muster in this book respond to different processes of change that have accelerated through history and generate the moment of globalization in our own day. It is critical for a book on world music to respond as extensively as possible to the sea change in global politics since the turn of the 21st century. The rise of right-wing populism, the spread of migration and refugee crises, and the escalation of climate change have global dimensions that are increasingly sounded in world music. The different case studies of music and musicians in this volume focus comparatively on the changing conditions in which world music comes into being and circulates. The various stages of the digital revolution, now a half century old, have led to revolutionary transformations in the very ontologies and epistemologies of world music. Because of such transformations, more people worldwide have greater access to world music than ever before in history. The traditional becomes the modern. The classical enters the everyday. Even at the moment the digital revolution opened new portals to music through the internet at the end of the 20th century, for instance, it would have been virtually impossible to predict that hundreds of performances of the same Hindustani raga would be immediately accessible on YouTube, some of them claiming the potential to circumvent the traditional guru-sisya parampara of South Asian music. The increased digital mediation of world music notwithstanding, the present volume also recognizes the ways, often paradoxical, in which world music sustains the physical and material conditions that afford it ontological and epistemological presence in the lives of human beings. Several of the issues connecting the chapters of the book, such as music's mobility, extend traditional contexts to the present, for example, the global refugee crisis, while others create bridges to problems whose urgency has become more acute than ever, for example, climate change and cultural sustainability. By examining the many ways in which world music participates in change over time and sustains its critical presence in our own lived-in worlds, we witness the ways the past and the present enhance each other, as do the historical and ethnographic study of world music. The historical and global landscape of world music is vast, encompassing the themes that coalesce as the many moments I investigate in this book. In order to clarify the ways the structure of this book represents such diverse moments of world music, I briefly sketch that structure here. The book unfolds as a series of thematic leitmotifs, each one forming a chapter. Though the chapter-length leitmotifs differ, their overall structures are similar, thereby making it possible to achieve an appropriately wide range of coverage. All chapters employ the same structure, that is, the same six sections through which I follow the leitmotif of the different chapters. Each chapter begins with an encounter, and it proceeds through a series of historical, theoretical, and aesthetic sections via vignettes of musicians and scholars before arriving at popular music and the present. Within each chapter, I strive for internal consistency, returning in subsequent chapters to a point of beginning so that each chapter might become a narrative of encounter for the listener. The schema here summarizes the organizational structure of each chapter. 1. Encounter with world music. 2. Historical or theoretical excursus. 3. Profile of a musician or group of musicians. 4. Aesthetic issue, especially an examination of meaning and identity in music. 5. Profile of an ethnomusicologist or group of scholars engaged with music globally. 6. Ethnographic present and popular music. Some of the encounters that fill the book come from my own experiences as an ethnomusicologist, especially those shaped by collaboration. They may come, more or less directly, from my own fieldwork. They may grow from historical and musical texts I've gathered over decades of archival work. They may represent, rather more indirectly, musical practices that I have experienced through theoretical engagement. For example, my special concern with the relation between religion and music. They may resound with the lessons I have learned during the past two decades as an active performer, the artistic director of the New Budapest Orpheum Society. They may also arise from my own attempts to forge an approach that would enable me, and I hope others, to understand something of the whole of world music. The first edition of this book was not initially my idea, but that of George Miller, who at the time stewarded the very short introductions through Oxford University Press. George put his faith in my ability to carry out the project, and I hope that, also in this edition, he might recognize my deep appreciation. I have been no less fortunate to have Jenny Noogie as the OUP editor for the present edition, above all because she has demonstrated such willingness to entertain many, rather than fewer, approaches to surveying the vast topics that typically become the subjects of very short introductions. I wish also to thank Edwin Pritchard for his careful and thoughtful copy editing. While thinking about the ways this book responds to music in a changing world, I have benefited from the thoughts and ideas of several communities of readers and scholars who have critically engaged with the book. The first of these communities is that remarkable community I humbly and appreciatively recognize as my students, with a dedication to this book. Above all, my students have taught me that one indispensable goal of the book has been to encourage an inclusive and capacious attitude toward music. My planning for this book profited in ways I could not have predicted from the translators of its first edition into Chinese, Hungarian, Italian, Japanese, Turkish, and Ukrainian, all of whom approached their task from the outset by seeking to make the book meaningful to the widest possible readership. I cannot thank you enough. My debt to two groups of colleagues in Chicago and Germany is enormous. What a marvelous community of ethnomusicologists we have had at the University of Chicago over many years. Jessica Swanston Baker, Melvin Butler, Travis A. Jackson, Kaylee Mason, Ingrid T. Monson, Anna C. Schultz, and Martin Stokes. Over the course of recent years, Berlin and Hanover have become my homes away from home, and I have therefore also accumulated the need to extend deep thanks to a host of German colleagues and friends, especially to Lars Christian Koch, Raimund Vogels, and that non-Berliner Berliner Fabian Holt. At each of my personal and professional moments as a scholar of world music, there is one thing that has remained forever steadfast, the abiding thanks to my family. As it does each time I bring a book to its close, the final word of acknowledgement here goes to Andrea, Ben, and Christine, now joined by Danielle and Riley, a marvelous collective of world and world-class musicians if there ever was one. Thanks for being there as we encountered music in the many places it has come to inhabit, wherever and whenever world music mattered so very much. Philip V. Bohlman, Oak Park and Berlin. Chapter 1. In the Beginning, Myth and Meaning in World Music. First Encounters, First encounters with world music happen in many different ways. Some of us travel great distances to encounter music quite unlike anything we know from our home. Others first become aware of world music close to home, perhaps because of the arrival of immigrants or refugees from elsewhere, perhaps through an epiphany that the familiar was not what we had imagined it to be. For still others, first encounters come through recordings, internet links, or sundry forms of representation that draw attention to the distance between home and away, and possess the power to close that gap. First encounters with world music are often personal, even intimate experiences, engendering a sudden awareness of local knowledge. Such awareness seldom leaves us untouched. Rather, it transforms us, often deeply. In our different ways, we may greet world music with awe and wonderment, fear and reverence. We may marvel at the serenity of its simplicity or the cacophony of its complexity. We may find ourselves lost in a search for meanings not immediately apparent, but transformed through unexpected revelation. However and wherever first encounters take place, they profoundly change what we perceive music to be and how we understand its meanings in the lives of human beings. First encounters are the stuff of story and history. Thus, they are of great interest for us in this book. Myth overflows with tales of first encounters. Just as myths tell about the intersections between the natural and the supernatural, or between humans and deities, so too do they account for how music emerges at those intersections. In myths, supernatural beings often confer music upon humans as a gift. The gift may be abstract, opening a path to communication. It might also be concrete, for example, in the forging of musical instruments from physical objects, such as human or animal bodies, which thereby acquire metaphysical meaning. Where music originates differs more in degree than kind in the myths of the world's religions. Music may be evident in the song of a bird or the voice of a god, or it may simply be out there in the music of the spheres. Tales about the origins of music have a virtually universal presence in religions throughout the world, suggesting that mythological encounters may be among the first conditions of world music. We also weave the stories about first encounters into the grand narratives that form our histories of world music. Let us turn briefly to one of the earliest of these stories. The first encounter between the musics of old and new worlds took place in 1557 during the sojourn of a Swiss Huguenot missionary, Jean de Lery, 1536 to 1613, among the Tupinamba at what is today the Bay of Rio de Janeiro. In a 1578 account, Lery wrote extensively about the music of the Tupinamba, even including transcriptions of melodies and texts used in specific rituals, domesticating it as if, in his memory, they sounded more like European church music. Figure 1. Lery did not travel to the New World to write dispassionate ethnographic observations, but rather to evangelize and convert, and his account therefore contains observations motivated by missionary zeal. The Tupinamba were cannibals, and the customs accompanying consumption of their fellow human beings especially caught Lery's attention. They also caught the attention of other writers of the day, not least among them Montaigne, whose essay On Cannibals, largely a series of reflections on Lery's writings, led to wide dissemination of Lery's description of the first encounter. Lery's writings on Tupinamba music and their reception set a tradition of writing about world music in motion, a tradition that would accelerate through the Age of Discovery and the early modern era, culminating in Herder's late 18th century collection of folk songs. It is not even that Lery's account transformed a first encounter into an ethnographic moment that is important, but rather that he sensed the music of Tupinamba ritual was not so very different from the music of his own tradition, which he regarded as beginning with the Greeks and unfolding as Western music history. Lery described a process of growing closer to the music of the Tupinamba, undergoing an aesthetic conversion of his own, from an initial stage in which Tupinamba songs were meaningless to one in which he felt a closeness, even a recognizable kinship. At the beginning of this witch's Sabbath, when I was in the women's house, I had been somewhat afraid. Now I received in recompense such joy, hearing the measured harmonies of such a multitude, and especially in the cadence and refrain of the song. Whenever I remember it, my heart trembles, and it seems their voices are still in my ears. Lery, History of a Voyage to the Land of Brazil, page 142 and 143. It is in the nature of first encounters with world music that our memory of them produces an almost physical return to the encounter itself. This is the nature of musical ethnography. The common practices of physically being present when others are making music that provides a common thread to the methods shared by ethnomusicology, popular music and folk music study, sound studies, and the other disciplines concerned with world music. Each time we attempt to make sense of musical phenomena differing from what is familiar, we return to first encounters, sometimes to retrieve information, but most often to remember again what it meant to experience world music for the first time. Reflecting on such encounters makes the best case for what happens when we experience world music, for, as in the case of Jean de Lary in the mid-16th century, transfiguration and transcendence, sometimes quite remarkable, accompany the encounter with music outside our own worlds, transforming it to world music. First meanings of world music. One of the first things we learn upon encountering world music is that music has different meanings elsewhere in the world. On one hand, music participates in cultural activities and connects to the world in ways unfamiliar to us. On the other, what is understood as music itself might be entirely different, or what we think music to be might not be regarded as such. Knowing what music is and what it does may have little to do with categories that seem entirely natural to us. As we encounter world music, it is important to recognize the need to reckon with different epistemologies and ontologies if we are also to understand what world music can mean in its virtually infinite varieties. By the epistemology of music, we mean its ability to be a part of culture as a whole, and thus to acquire meaning in relation to other activities. Examining music cross-culturally, we recognize that religious meaning accrues to music in many ways. Music may serve as a vehicle for shaping the voice of a deity. It may demarcate time so that it is more meaningful for the performance of ritual. Music may provide one of many ornaments that make religious practice more attractive. Certain domains of music making, for example, instrumental music in many religions, may raise images of magic or immortality, even causing some religions to prohibit music in worship. It is to understand such epistemological questions in world music more completely that ethnomusicology has adopted approaches from the social sciences, especially from anthropology, with its fundamental concern for cultural context. The ontologies of world music, music's properties of being part of a lived-in world, are more likely to reveal themselves in musical texts and practice. The basic ontological question is simple: what is music? If the question is simple, the answers are not, for world musics have very distinctive and contradictory ontologies. From a Western standpoint, it often seems as if the ontologies of world music are untranslatable, especially because the most fundamental ontological categories in the West treat music as if it were an object, a thing that itself possesses meaning. The language with which we talk about music and the ways in which we interpret it conspire to harden the objectified ontologies of our own music. An ontology derived from understanding music as an object is foreign to many music cultures in the world, where, for example, there may be no equivalent linguistic category for affording identity to individual pieces. The most extreme instances of world music's ontological complexity are music cultures lacking a word equivalent to the Western concept of music. The musical culture of the largely Muslim Hausa people of northern Nigeria is a classic case of an ontology that contains a considerable vocabulary for distinguishing musicians, musical practices, and instruments, but no word for music itself. Clearly, the panoply of epistemologies and ontologies reveals itself in the ways we talk about music and the words we employ to give meaning to music. Box 1 contains a few of the countless terms used to ascribe ontological meaning to world music. The point here is not to suggest that such terms are equivalent to the Western music, but rather to urge listeners to question why seeking equivalent identities usually impedes discovery of deeper meanings. Box 1. Ontologies of world music. Ma. Aesthetic emptiness and silence in Japanese music, perceived as an ontological entity in and of itself, rather than as a space, for example, rest, between sounded music. Musica mundana, Music of the Spheres, a Neoplatonic concept employed by philosophers to account for music in the harmonic order of the universe. Ngoma, a concept encompassing a range of practices in the instrumental music of southern and eastern Africa. Glossed from the Bantu for drum and drumming, Ngoma further describes the social intersections of different genres and performance styles. Qira'a, recitation of the Quran, literally reading or calling in Islam, never considered to be music. Rasa, an emotional or spiritual condition in the music of South and Southeast Asia, figuratively from the Sanskrit for taste, essence, mood, attained by proper performance of various attributes, some musical and others extra musical. Sama, Arabic word translatable as both hearing and listening. Musical experience in Islam, determined by.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.